other individual investigators to make the data more interoperability, talking about standards. But perhaps for this audience more important, there are over 1,000 publications from outside of ENCODE that use ENCODE data. Some of these look at human disease, some of these look at basic biology, and they cover a wide spectrum of diseases, and I think that this attests to the translational value of the resource. So in summary, this is we're trying to create a catalog of whole functional elements of the genome. This is freely shared with the community. The foundation for this is established techniques and methodologies that have been used for years of gene regulation studies, and these maps can be used to make predictions about genome function. This should help you out work. So now we're going to take a quick peek at how you might use ENCODE to study the role of genetic variation in human disease. And here I'm going to give you a few use cases, some ideas that I've gleaned from the literature, which is not the only sum total of what can be done. The major idea here is that ENCODE supports hypothesis generation and refinement. Okay? High throughput data are useful in identifying hypothesis tests. And some of these things are predicting causal variants for traits or diseases, predicting target genes for either regulatory elements or genetic variants, cell types that are affected by regulatory elements or variants, and then also predicting upstream regulators, understanding pathways of how these systems work. So prediction of causal variants, some of this is obvious problems, others it's not obvious that this is an issue. But if one does a study such as GWAS, you get a locus, but there are other variants that are in LZ. So that doesn't tell you on that first step what is the causal variant. ENCODE type annotations can be used as one find mapping strategy. You've also got the issue that it's possible that multiple variants work on the same trait or disorder. You might not be trying to find the causal variant, rather a group of them. So ENCODE data can help you figure that out. And a recently published study looked at ENCODE and comments on the roadmap of genomics data found that many GWAS findings overlap with these annotations. So that suggests that this could be used. If one is not familiar with these kinds of assays, the simplest way to get started is there are a couple of pre-computed resources. First, I'll tell you about HaploRank from Ellis Ellis' group at MIT that can help you sort through ENCODE and roadmap data. And with HaploRank, you can set one, put in genomic coordinates for SNP IDs or list of them, and then click submit. And then it will return pre-computed analysis of ENCODE data. This is just the first step of the kind of result that you get returned. And it'll show you for both the lead SNP and others that are in LZ what kinds of ENCODE and roadmap annotations are found in that area. And that can help guide you in further experiments to decide what you want to do next. Similarly, Mike Snyder's group and Mike Cherry's group, both at Stanford, developed regular TV, and in a different way, this analyzes ENCODE data, roadmap data, and some other data sources. Again, you can put in genomic coordinates for SNP IDs, and then quick move on, and initially you're presented with a score, the likelihood that the genomic region you're looking at has regulatory potential, and then of course you can drill down and see the individual underlying data and see why that assessment came about. As Gene said at the beginning, I meant to say at the beginning, but forgot, please don't worry about writing down URLs or detailed explanations. All of these slides are going to be shared, so that information will be available to everybody. There's also ENCODE's Swiss Element browser, and this has a number of different functions for human data and mouse data, and in this example, you can input in a genomic coordinate, and it will find candidate regulatory elements, in this case, points that by looking for DNA transcription sites, and also tell you about candidate upstream regulators by looking for motifs that are found in those regions. And prediction of target genes is also an interesting problem. GTEx and ENCODE data and other projects are finding that it's not unusual that regulatory sites don't work on the nearest gene. They work on some gene that's further away. So one finds a piece of DNA that you think is important, and it's not protein coding, if you just guess that the nearest gene is its target, the growing stories will be wrong at least half the time. Okay. And if we look at, for instance, predictions based on GWAS studies, a lot of times it's quite distant that the regulatory region is from a gene. And in practical sense, what this could mean is you might have some variant of interest and start studying the nearest gene, but perhaps there's a better candidate that one could work with a better prediction. And that could change your research project if you didn't have to spend a few months studying one gene, studying an expert, or only filter with proximity. If you knew other principles ways to say what this would like the candidate, you could come up with a better answer. So you can do this by using regulatory elements database. Jerry Fury's lab developed this. And it works in a number of different ways. One of the things you can do is put in genomic coordinates, and it'll again report DNA hypersensitive sites in that region, candidate regulatory regions. And if you click on any of them, it tells you additional information. And one of the things it'll tell you is if there's a prediction for what gene is the likely target of that, will give you a confidence estimate and what that target gene might be. The ENCODE Swiss Element browser, which I pointed out before, and in the bottom of these slides, you can see that you're going to be hearing more about this in workshop session 3, for example. So this is just a very quick overview, but again, you can put in a gene name, and this tool will return to you what are regulatory elements that appear, what are candidate regulatory elements that might be linked to this gene. Okay. And the one that I highlighted here is one that I showed in that initial example, showing a common control region that affected many genes. I chose that region, that example, because it knows this has been very well worked out, that region's been knocked out, and it does in fact control these genes. If you go to ENCODE human data, you could make the same prediction without having any of them. And last use case, I'll tell you about predicting target cell types. Again, to some people, this is surprising that this is something you would need to do, so others it's intuitive. But if you think about most human diseases affect several cell types. Sometimes they affect several cell types directly, sometimes it's more subtle. For instance, sometimes the affected cell type is a developmental niche for the cell type that actually shows the dramatic effect. There are people who have lack of lymphocytes because their thymus, the niche where lymphocytes develop, is impaired. Right? So the affected cell type is not where that gene appears. And sometimes, of course, the etiology of the disease is not well understood. I'm old enough to be able to remember when it was a wild and crazy idea that type 1 diabetes, a metabolic disorder, might involve the immune system that we now know is an autoimmune disorder. But for some fraction of the pieces that we work on today, we don't know the cell types. So again, a regulatory element database, if you call up different elements, in some cases, those elements appear to be active in only some cell types. Other elements appear to be broadly utilized. So that could give you some information about cell types that's affected. Similarly, if you look at haplorite and regular TV, which I talked about briefly, when you see the underlying evidence, for instance, mouse over something in haplorite, it tells you the cell types that data came from. And that could guide your hypothesis, especially if something's known about the disease, like Alzheimer's, okay, neurons, macrophages, real cells, and you're hitting this for real cells, right? Then that helps you refine things. It's more difficult to use if nothing is known about the disease. And if you're looking at the ENCODE Swiss Element browser, and for instance, look at gene expression, you can type a mouse or human gene in. It might be the gene that you think is important in that disease. It's just expressed in a restricted number of cell types. Obviously, some other genes are broadly expressed. And that, again, could guide your hypothesis as to what's going on. A more principled way to do this is if you take regulate, you could intersect genetic variants that are linked to disorder. So intersect them with regulatory elements, and then ask whether those regulatory elements are enriched in particular cell types. And the code for doing this is shared in the URL on the slide. And then you can ask in a more principled way which of several candidate cell types might be involved in a particular disorder process. So in summary, I think the main thing that a code can help with is hypothesis generation and this can be used to predict causal variants, to predict target genes, to predict cell types, clustering regulators. All of the examples I showed you are examples of how you could use this with genetic results. If you have epigenetic results or epigenetic cohort, you could do many of the same things with encode data. Of course, if you're skilled in that, then you know that some additional caveats apply. The same kind of thing I showed in germline examples. But one could do all of this with somatic variants, but again, additional caveats apply when you have that. Now, I'm going to quickly run through how you can access encode reserves. You're going to hear a lot more about this, at least with jobs 2, 1, and 5. So the encode portal, encodeproject.org, that's the one URL I would want you to remember, encodeproject.org. I have a lot of this info. And for instance, you can access data on your research matrix. You get a matrix, there's a nice representation, which I've crudely trimmed so you can't see most of it. It shows you the kind of data that's offered, data types, projects that the data come from, and so forth. And you can use facets to narrow down the subset of the data that you want to see. I want to emphasize the data policy. As I said at the beginning, this is freely shared. So if the data are there, you can use it. There's no restriction, no embargo or anything. But you ask the standard scientific thing that you cite the project, like with any other data source you use, it's cited. So reasons of transparency and reproducibility is because you share accession numbers. If you share the accession numbers of what you did, then your peers can tell what you did and how you did it. Okay. New to the ENCODE portal is for search by region. You can put in a genomic coordinator SNP ID, find ENCODE data that overlaps with that region, and visualize it. That's a quick way for those of you that want to see trends, once you download elements to get your data. There's an ENCODE encyclopedia. You're going to be hearing about this. It's going to be focused on SHOT 1. And it has high level and very close to the data analysis. It has a range of things. Ground level, close to the data annotations, and things like where our transcription factors bound. Middle level annotations are putting the data together to find things like where our promoters and enhancers and how can you visualize them. And then top level annotations put together many different types of data to generate inferences. You'll be hearing about that, especially in workshop 5. ENCODE publications, again, there are community publications that I would point out to you because there are examples of how people outside of ENCODE are using the data to study human disease, to study basic biology, produce software tools. There are also ENCODE print publications that can illustrate what was done and how the data can be used. We're very interested in sharing standards for how things are done, and this is done again for the same two reasons, for transparency, so that you know what was done and how it was done, so you can evaluate for yourself how credible this is. And then we're also sharing the standards because there are many people in the field that are including something new in the field and they're wondering, how should I be doing this? We hold this out as one way that you can do it, but of course it's for each group to decide how to do it. We don't dictate standards to anybody, so you click through and see different types of standards and experiment documents that we share. We're sharing software that we're using in the project, again, so that people can understand what was done and how it was done, or if people are doing this kind of work and want to use software. Some of this software was created by ENCODE, some of this software was created outside of the project, but we use it heavily, so they're both important to know about, and we share both of those kinds of software. And lastly, I'd like to give a shout out to our partners at the International Human Epigenomics Consortium. ENCODE is a member of this, which is the NIH Common Fund Project Roadmap Epigenomics. A bunch of like-minded projects are collecting epigenomic data across many cell types and sharing them through different mechanisms. The ENCODE IHEC data portal and project summary are available. There's lots of useful data there, including subset of the ENCODE data. So I want to finalize here with a list of URLs that I don't expect you to read now or write down now. Again, all of these slides are shared. Click on the links rather than write them down, but we share, for instance, tutorials from the project, including the results of this will get posted online, analysis tools in the portal, and IHEC resources. I highlight the ENCODE mailing list. If you want to hear regular updates on the project, you can join this list. So I'll conclude by reminding you that the goals of ENCODE are to find all of the candidate functional regions of the genome. This is an aspirational goal. I think there's no way to know when it's done or how it's done. And we're freely sharing the results that we find as a resource to the community. And ENCODE data are already being used in studies of human disease, human biology, and disease any way that anyone can come up with. I'll stop here by thanking people in the ENCODE consortium first. There's another representation of some of them. I have the privilege of working with smart people every day and hearing great ideas. It makes my job really fun. And my program colleagues at NHGRI, Elise and Peter Good, started the ENCODE project long before I had anything to do with it. Dan Gilchrist and I work on that project now along with Elise. And Dan is here today. I heard you say hi to Dan as well. And they're great colleagues and people to work with. And of course, all of this work, like any other bit of science, is built on years of study that came before it. Lots of work on gene regulation, lots of work on genetic basis of human disease. So I'll stop there and take any questions if anybody has any questions, or we can move on to the next one. Okay, so now what I'd like to do is introduce our first scientific speaker, our keynote speaker. Have a question, thank you.
So regarding the ENCODE feature, so what are the HDR plans to do? Like, what kind of focus on emphasize?
Sure. Some of this is public record, and some of this is to be decided yet. I can tell you about public record part. And we've recently accepted applications for a round in ENCODE. They haven't been reviewed, funding decisions haven't been made. But the applications we accepted were for pneumatic centers, sort of like the production centers that we have now. Computational analysis centers, as an ongoing activity that we have now in ENCODE. And then a new type of activity, functional characterization centers. We also have applications for those, in addition to a data coordinating center and a data analysis center. So there's a good chance that moving forward, there'll be more data production in ENCODE, more mapping. Releases of data through the DCC and analysis, and then we might have additional information about function of different genomic regions. Past iterations of ENCODE did not focus on functional analysis of the mapping results. The thought was that was within the purview of the community. The idea was to do the mapping and to come up with raw material for others to work on. But we've seen that this is a need for us as well to be involved in, so that's why that's coming. Thank you. To our keynote speaker, we're honored to have Nancy Cox here from Vanderbilt, and she's going to tell us about her recent work looking at genetic contributions to gene regulation and how learning about that can help us understand about the role of genetics in human traits and human disorders. So please join me in welcoming Nancy. Thanks. Thanks. It's a real pleasure to be here. This is such a great meeting, and I've been really looking forward to sharing some of the newest findings. So I really want to get some feedback from an audience like this one and more collaborations with my ENCODE colleagues, because while this project was very much grounded in and started by research that we were doing in GTEC, it is very much like we end up in deeply looking at ENCODE. So Well, I'm going to do today, I think over about a year ago, I was talking about initial results in about 5,000 subjects from BioView. And what I'm going to talk about today are results of studies that we've been doing with our PredictScan methodology in about 20,000 BioView subjects on our way to about 120,000. So there'll be some novel genes, phenotype discoveries, and more on the continuum from Mendelian to common disease in a number of different dimensions. Some new ways that I think we have to really get more kinds of insights into biological mechanisms of disease and new big picture biology that relates to the medical phenome as a concept in and of itself, separate from individual diseases. So just to review, a lot of what I'm going to talk about is centered on this analysis tool that we have worked on for GTEx called PredictScan. The idea is, again, when we measure gene expression, there's some component of that that is entirely genetically determined. Most of it is attributable to other kinds of exposures and to the feedback of traits and diseases on what we measure as transcript levels. But we can use what we measure in something like GTEx to develop SNP-based predictors of gene expression that then we can test with phenotype. So this is already published by Last Year Nature Genetics, and all of the software, It's on your bingo sheet. It's actually publicly available on GitHub and continuously updated as we're able to get more data from GTEx for building the predictors. So we use GTEx as a reference panel to build these prediction equations and to create a really big database for each gene in each tissue, all of the SNP predictors that come into the prediction equation and the associated weights. We're using ElasticNet for building the predictions. But that means, so once that's created, in any data set where we just have the genome variation, and that can be GWAS level, it can be whole genome sequencing, we can essentially impute transcript levels for each gene in each tissue and associate that calculated endophenotype with our traits of interest, in this case, the medical phenome that we have in BioView. And it has, in any given tissue, there are only about 4,000 to 9,000 genes that have really high quality prediction. But across all of the tissues that we measure in GTEx, we're getting now high quality prediction in about 18,000 genes. So, and this is with just the first half of the GTEx data that will come in. So that will improve over time. We've also not used ENCODE annotations in this first pass through in building the predictions. That's something that I think people are looking at and working on. So the quality of the prediction may improve as we can include more information from ENCODE annotations and building the predictors. Plus, we've only built cis predictors of gene expression at this point. As GTEx matures and we have larger samples, we expect to be able to use at least the top